This is an interview of Professor B.A. Zikria about his recent books. B.A. Zikria, born in Afghanistan, came to America at the age of 18 to study medicine. He finished college in 3 years, studied at Johns Hopkins Medical School in Baltimore, and received his diploma from President Eisenhower, brother of Milton Eisenhower, president of Johns Hopkins. He trained in Bellevue and Columbia Presbyterian Medical Centers. He taught medical students at the College of Physicians and Surgeons for 25 years and trained surgeons at CPMC and affiliated Harlem Hospital for 45 years. He has received 10 U.S. patents during his career. After his retirement, he began writing philosophical and historical books. Dr. Zikria, American as well as Afghan writers have lauded your second marvelous historical novel in 2017. Please allow me to quote Paul Fitzgerald and Elizabeth Gould, who wrote, "Professor Zikria has written an inspirational novel about the ideals of freedom and individual human rights embodied in the Declaration of Independence and the American Constitution." Zikria draws deeply on his own love of these values and his expertise as a physician, poet, scientist, philosopher, and historian to create a story that all Americans today can be inspired by. An Afghan historian, Professor A.K. Rashid, Ph.D., presently at Jawaharlal Nehru Institute, stated, "I studied and read the manuscript non-stop and found it attractively written so that younger generations can learn and enjoy history in a new style. My heart prayed for him. Sardar, may your pen be forever full of ink, and may your heart be always filled with love and overflow with success like your ancestors." Professor Zikria, let us start with your latest historical novel, Malala, Joan of Arc of Afghanistan and the Victors of Maywand. Please, tell us about Malala the heroine.
I think Malala, the name, some people probably are acquainted because within the past few years, a young girl who was shot in the head by the Taliban was taken to London, and she recovered. And because of her struggle for the rights of young girls to be educated and rights of women, she received the Nobel Prize. And after the Nobel Prize she received, she wrote a book called I Am Malala. Her father had named her after this heroine that I'm writing about in this book, Malala of Maywand, the Joan of Arc of Afghanistan.
During the Second Anglo-Afghan War of 1878 to 1882, in the formidable Battle of Maywand, an 18-year-old daughter of a shepherd named Malala snatched victory from the jaws of the British Lion. In the scorched plain of Maywand in southwestern Afghanistan, the temperature was over 90 degrees Fahrenheit at 10 a.m. and rising. Around noontime, in the height of the heat, the British infantry units commenced their intense volley fire against the advancing Afghans. The Afghan soldiers and villagers began to fall like leaves. The Afghan army's left flank fell back and some began to flee. Malala was providing cups of water to thirsty soldiers when an Afghan standard bearer in front of her was shot dead. She ran and picked up the banner and shouted her lande, a Japanese haiku-like poem. "Oh, young love, if you're not martyred in the Battle of Maywand, know that you're kept alive as a symbol of shame." She kept screaming her poem and waving to the retreaters to return to their line. The troops, hearing her, turned back to the line, shouting, "Freedom or death!" Commander-in-Chief Prince Ayub, having observed the break of the left flank of his army, ordered his Afghan-made guns to be moved out of the main ravine to higher ground. Malala turned her head back and saw the row of Afghan cannons starting their sequential fires. She heard someone shouting her name in the midst of screams, crackles of rifles, and deafening sounds of cannons. She slowed down and saw her fiancé Zalmay far behind her shouting, "Wait for me! Wait for me!" She stalled for her fiancé to catch up. The battle's cacophony was piercing her ears and tearing her poetic heart. Zalmay made it to her side, shouting, "Let me run in front of you to clear the way." Only a few yards had they run, facing the enemy, when a salvo of English guns started cutting down the Afghan soldiers on their tracks. An anti-personnel cannon shot tore Zalmay's shoulder and chest. A drop of his blood landed on Malala's cheek as he fell. Malala reached and knelt by his side, wiped the blood from his handsome face, kissed his forehead, and closed his fixed, staring eyes. She stood up straight and cried out loud from the bottom of her heart, "A drop of my beloved's blood shed in defense of motherland sits on my face as a beauty spot turns garden of red roses ashamed." Malala continued to sing her lande. As more soldiers were hearing it, a bullet pierced Malala's heart and she fell to the ground. In the British camp, Afghan cannons had raised havoc on the British artillery and cavalry ranks. The British gun carriages were being driven wild and confused, turning their escape from this inferno into an infamous rout. As the crimson western horizon began to pull down the veil of dusk to hide this horrific scene of men's savagery to men of blood and gore, Prince Ayub declared victory, and Malala was named the heroine of Maywand for perpetuity. Malala, Joan of Arc of Afghanistan and the Victors of Maywand, by B.A. Zikria.
Tell us, why were the British so interested in Afghanistan after having lost the First Anglo-Afghan War of 1838 to 1842?
Afghanistan essentially is located geographically in the center of Asia and on the way of the old Silk Road. Mm-hmm. And it has a very important geopolitical position because on its north is Central Asia and Russia. On its northeast and east is China and Pakistan and India. At that time it was British Empire, mm-hmm. was on its east and the south. And on the west is Iran, and from the Indian Sea, also all the Arab nations. So it's located in a very geopolitically very sensitive place. And any of these neighbors would had to control Afghanistan, they would control the region.
I see.
Just like Switzerland. Yeah. Switzerland in Europe is in the heart of Europe. In early 1800s, as the British start conquering Indian subcontinent, they pretty much by the second half of 1800 completely dominated and occupied India subcontinent. Mm-hmm. And the Russian Tsarist Empire was expanding also southward in Central Asia and was coming towards Afghanistan to the border of Afghanistan, which pretty much scared the British, mm-hmm. threatening British India. So there was, and that was called in early 1800s as the Great Game.
I see.
By one of the Great English game. Soldiers, Lieutenant Conway, called it Game, and then it took off, and it's now a historically well-known thing, the Great Game. The game between the two empires, the Tsarist Empire in the north of Afghanistan and the British Empire in the east and south of Afghanistan. And it was a critical territory that British were afraid that the Russian Tsarist army can one day come in through Afghanistan and conquer India. And one of the things my book tries to tell us the lessons of history. Afghanistan, like many mountainous countries like Switzerland, mm-hmm. they are by nature become fighters. And these people essentially in a very harsh climate that they live on mountains and so forth, very tough people. And they are somehow, the mountain people are so much in love with their freedom and liberty. The same thing in Swiss. The Swiss, you know, if you remember Swiss guards, yes. They were so great warriors that up till now, Pope's guard is from Switzerland, yes. The Swiss guards, because they were great fighters. But the British came and tried to occupy in First Anglo-African War, 1848-1842. And they occupied and replaced the king, or the people liked, the people's king, by their own noble king from Afghanistan, a prince, another prince. They replaced leadership. But it didn't work, and they had to get out. And in getting out, they lost between 13 to 16,000 soldiers and camp people retreating from Kabul, the capital. British then tried about 4 years again, the Second Anglo-African War. And they occupied, and people fought against them. They made a very good treaty, taking out all the cutting off Afghanistan's rights. Eastern, northwestern frontier area became British for the first time after the Second Anglo-African War. And then as they had to remove their armies, they did. And after their mission was actually assassinated in Kabul, they had to come back, and General Roberts, the very famous General Roberts of Kandahar, he came and come back and occupied the second largest city of Afghanistan, which is Kandahar.
Wow. Amazing, the back and forth there.
And then they were defeated again in Maiwand,
yes.
This book,
yes.
In the Second Anglo-African War. And after that defeat, they moved out of Afghanistan again, withdrew.
Professor Zikria, in your book, the young American physician wanted to take the American universal principles to Afghanistan as his father had done before him. What is your take on the American dream and American universal principles?
In my first historical novel called The Afghan Prince and I, the First American in Afghanistan, that was Josiah Harlan, the American, the first American who went to Afghanistan in 1830s, 1840s. And Josiah Harlan had a leather bag in which he carried always a copy of the Declaration of Independence and American Constitution. And he wanted to take it to four corners of the world. And his son, I made it in this second novel, historical novel, his son tries to do the same what his father did. And his father wanted to go back to Afghanistan before he died in San Francisco, as a matter of fact. And he couldn't make it, so his son wanted to fulfill his last will, to go back to Afghanistan, which he called Afghanistan, his father called it his second home, because he had lived almost 20 years over there. So the message of the Declaration of Independence, as a matter of fact, so much affected both of them. And me as a young man, when I came to Washington, D.C., I was just become 18, and I saw all the museums and the memorial. In the memorial of Thomas Jefferson, something happened to me that I was very much shaken up and sort of taken completely by Thomas Jefferson's ideas. There are a lot of carvings of his sayings on the walls, and they are very beautiful about the American Constitution. But on the dome of that memorial, I read this that grabbed me. He said, "I swear upon the altar of God, eternal hostility against all kinds of tyranny, against the mind of man." I said, wow.
How appropriate for this day.
Wow. What a saying, what a mind, what a consciousness expansion to the infinite with wisdom and to freedom. I became a follower of Thomas Jefferson.
How did the American Constitution achieve organization of the government and the balance of powers?
I was very impressed, and I have studied, of course, these things in depth. The French philosopher, he in 1860s, he wrote a book called The Law. And he first time he said about the three branches, talked about three branches of the government. But he never was able to speak because there was a king in France about freedom of speech. And whereas in American Constitution, the First Amendment is freedom of speech.
Yes.
Without the freedom of speech, there is no democracy. So what our forefathers did in the writing of the Constitution, they made it so that so well balanced, like a Swiss watch, ticking and going smoothly. The three branches, executive, judicial, and
legislative,
they made it three equal powers balancing against each other. But then recently, where we had all three branches of government were under one party system, I felt that we are a little bit in a danger that this solid foundation of three pillars may collapse, God forbid. But we are happy to see the fourth pillar is the free, unbiased news media. And we got to have a free, unbiased news media to continue smoothly the running of this beautiful watch.
With your background both in the United States and the Middle East, please tell us, how can America extricate itself from an interminable war in Afghanistan?
This is what I have started, the path that I have taken. After the 9/11, we had to go in there. There was no other choice. But now the question is, what is our choices after 17 years of still fighting?
Mm-hmm.
And we have to seek good, peaceful negotiations and some system of diplomacy that will change the picture and will be acceptable and bring sustainable peace and sustainable security. Mm-hmm. For Afghanistan, but also for us.
Mm-hmm.
We want sustainable security. Our country is in peace, but we want security, sustainable security for the rest of the 21st century.
Mm-hmm.
With all the extremisms that we see, we need sustainable security. So what I proposed, I'm going to write, as a matter of fact, my other books, in 1815, Europe was very much like what is today the world. You see the upside down things going. topsy-turvy. And I think the Vienna Congress in 1815 solved the problem because Switzerland was the central problem. First the French occupied it, then the Austrian Empire army came and occupied it, and then the Russians came and occupied. So they wanted, and that was very strategic place again, just like Afghanistan. All the neighbors wanted to rule it, yeah, so that they can rule the whole Europe. And so Prince Metternich, the foreign minister of Austrian Empire, he proposed that Switzerland become permanently neutralized, permanently neutral.
Guaranteed neutrality.
Guaranteed neutrality. And that solved the problem for that area. Not the First World and Second War, they couldn't prevent that, but Switzerland has been now the most developed, one of the richest countries, and has not seen war for almost over 250 years.
We would like to know more about your book, One Home, One Family, One Fortune, with Neil Armstrong's landing on the moon and its profound meaning for mankind.
When I watched on July 20th, 1969, landing of the Eagle on the moon, Neil Armstrong, before coming down the stairs to land a step on the moon, Aldridge asked him, said, are you prepared to say something beforehand? He said, no, I think God Almighty will help me say something good. As he stepped, he put his fourth foot, and it's in pictures, you know, the print of this foot. First step, he said, that's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. I tried to get in touch with him. It took me 2 years to make contact with him by email, one of the old secretaries.
Yeah.
And so we corresponded. My interpretation of his saying, which was a spontaneous, inspired thing, it was that small step, one small step for man, is the step of science and technology. We are continuing these steps, mm-hmm, of science and technology, and now it's becoming exponential. But what is the giant leap for mankind? This is giant leap for mankind. It's not for just Americans. It's for mankind. What did he mean with that? In my opinion, he meant the expansion of consciousness of man for the first time, to see himself, herself, from another celestial body as to who he is, who she is, where they are, and where they are going. It's like a child for the first time at the age of one stands in front of a mirror and recognizes himself. So it is a great leap into a consciousness of that kind, where we now see we have only in this dark, infinite space one beautiful jewel, our planet Earth, the blue-white jewel, which is our home, the only home we have.
Yes.
There are that people that live on that jewel is our bigger family.
Yes.
And then we are all in the same boat. We have the same future. One thing that I wanted to just also read for our audience, I think, you know, when you live in a beautiful place with all the facilities and with all the comforts the world can ever give to any person, you begin to live as if They are nothing. We forget from commonness of things that we have, we forget their importance. So I feel that this little excerpt that I'll read is in a speech one of our great personalities, American leader, had said about American Constitution. The Constitution of the United States is the impassioned and inspired vehicle by which we travel through history. It grew out of the deepest inspiration of our existence, that we are here to serve Him by living free. That living free releases in us the noble impulses and our best abilities so that we use these precious gifts for good and generous purposes, and that we will secure them not just only for ourselves and our children, but for all mankind.